Welcome back to HowToAV.tv. We're over at ISE 2019 at the AVIXA stand, and we're joined by Patrick Murray of Catch Technologies, who's literally just stepped off the AVIXA Fast Track stage, talking to integrators, talking to visitors to the show about the Internet of Things, and really how that integrates with audiovisual technology in this world. So, what can you tell us about, let's talk about IoT first of all, for those sure. people who don't understand what IoT is.
Right. Often, like when I first heard about the IoT, I kind of rolled my eyes because it sounded like a lot of marketing. And AV integrators have been integrating networks of things for a really long time. So if you have a touch panel and a serial device or IR, that is a network. Just it doesn't have to be IP. So what's the big deal about the IoT? Well, I think Amazon Alexa is a great example that everybody is familiar with. And when Amazon started advertising Alexa for Business, I was wondering, how is that going to work, right? How are they going to control my video projector or make the screen go up and down or do a switch on the matrix? And looking at this question more and more, it's not how will they control our stuff, it's how will AV systems become a part of the IoT? How are we going to integrate with the internet?
And therefore, do you think it's the responsibility of the system designer and the integrator to adopt these technologies as part of a larger system before the end user starts bringing in those smaller technologies themselves and really perhaps confuses the system?
Well, it's a really large discussion, but in the end, what it boils down to is that we need to consider the entire project lifecycle. Now, what I see quite often is that a system gets installed and then that's it. We deliver version one and that's our responsibility is filled. And when you're considering any kind of an internet connection, you have a responsibility to make sure that you have a way to update your systems because a vulnerability can be discovered at any time on any system. So you're going to need a way to patch that. And as soon as the internet is introduced, then you really need to look at the entire project lifecycle from the installation, the maintenance, upgrades, all the way down to decommissioning. If you throw a box away, is there any data on there that could cause a vulnerability? So it's a new idea, a new way of looking at projects and considering the entire life cycle.
And is this integration being driven by the installers, or is it the end users themselves who are saying, look, I'm using this technology already, I want it to be part of my larger system now?
Right, it comes back to the habits of IT. What is the IT industry doing? And their managed services are standard. SLAs, service level contracts, are standard. And it's only a matter of time before these things start showing up in our industry. And that's where the opportunity lies, to have a managed service contract in place where you are constantly in touch with your systems, you know what they're going on, you could react quickly, you could be informed when things go offline or errors are thrown, you could collect data and see how your systems are being used. And you could know, do I really need a TV tuner in the system anymore? And you can make database decisions. And of course, you have that connection to your customer that's long-term, and that's just good business.
Patrick, I know that you have a really strong background in software.
Yes.
And a lot of our integrators come from a much more analog industry, and IP and Internet of Things is all growing really, really fast.
Absolutely.
AVI over IT can be quite,
it's scary.
This is not for me now.
Right.
I'm going to pass this over to an IT guy. Is that necessary? Do you need to bring in IT skills? Do you need to bring in somebody else? Or can we train ourselves to expand the knowledge that we've got to bring the two technologies together?
It's a tough question, and I think it needs to, you need to look at what your niche is, who your customers are. If they have their own IT department, you're definitely going to need to have conversations with them, so you at least need a base level. You are never going to just know everything or learn everything and be ready to go. Every building meeting that you have, you'll get a new acronym that you'll go home and Google, but you need to have somebody on the staff that is ready to do that, that knows it's their job to keep up with all these things. And if you don't have the resources to do that, partnering with an IT company is really a great way to approach that problem.
And a problem that we used to hear a lot of is that the IT manager of a building was locking down his network. I don't think that's the case anymore. I think the IT guys are really starting to understand the possibilities and how this technology can work. Would you say that the relationship has got much better?
Well, the relationship has changed, of course, but it's not their decision in most cases. The stakeholders are the ones who decide what gets implemented. So if a stakeholder sees value in collecting data on how their AV systems are being used, if they want to know if rooms are actually occupied or not, if they want to know that a system will work instead of actually walking around to rooms and testing them every single morning to have some kind of a monitoring system in place to be informed of that earlier, then you know these things will get implemented and then we have to work together. Customers just want things to work, right? We could order something online, whether it be an Echo Dot or a Fire Stick or an Apple TV, whatever it is, we take it out of the box, plug it in, and it just works. And that's the same kind of experience that end users are looking for in the office. Of course, we know when you get into things like sound reinforcement and video distribution and collaboration, those are really complicated systems to design and install, and we'll always have that part to play, but the operation of the system should be the same experience. You should just walk in and it should work. And that's a challenge, but we could do that with these types of systems that give us that constant connection.
I guess another concern, something we've not covered yet, is security.
Of course.
So, what tips, what advice have you got that people should really be considering to make sure that they are providing a safe system for their customers?
Absolutely. The biggest thing to know about security is that it's a team sport. You will never choose one vendor and be able to say my system is secure. It always involves the vendor, the integrator, whoever's commissioning the system, and the technology owner. So the vendor needs to make their products capable of being secure. The integrator has to actually use those features. They need to implement them, change the passwords, and use a password manager to communicate those passwords to the end user. Don't put them in an Excel list and put them in a Dropbox or email them to them. There are best practices for these types of things. And the technology owners really need to realize that it's up to them to put pressure on us to make sure these tasks get carried out.
Patrick, it sounds to me that we are literally just scratching the surface.
Indeed.
We are very like-minded people, we've just found out. Tell us about your YouTube channel that does something very similar from a software side.
Of course. We have a website called learnavprogramming.com, and there are tons of great resources for learning programming on the internet, but I wasn't able to find anything that really specified, that was specific for AV, that did the things we do. So we started making courses online. A lot of them are free, so I encourage everybody to go check them out. And I also have a podcast called Software Defined Survival, where we interview people like yourself to just find out how everybody's dealing with the changes that are going on in our industry. And that the major change for me is the commoditization of computing power. Computing power is cheap and it's easy to get, and it's really affecting the way our business is done.
Sounds to me like we found ourselves a brand new AV expert for How to AV, really understanding software and the IP side of things. If you've got a question that you think that Patrick will be able to answer, fire it through to us. Leave it in the comments section below. I'll contact Patrick and see if I can persuade him to join us again at HowToAV.tv. Thanks, Patrick.
Thank you.